Okay, so hi everyone. So thank you for being here. My name is Erwan Goyou. I'm working for STA Microelectronics in Le Mans, in France. And I will. So the aim of this talk is to provide you some information on if you want to start using Zephyr on STM32. So a bit about myself. So I started working on Zephyr in 2016, a few months after the project was released. Okay, sorry for this. So I've been working on embedded before, but this was my very first step in an open source project. Initially, I contributed as a linear RAS assignee, so I was still I was ST Microelectronics employee, but I was using I was part of a linear team. So I contributed to device reintroduction. I'm STM32 on Shield maintainer, and within ST, I'm Zephyr technical leader. So you can find me on GitHub or Discord. So that's it for myself. Let's jump to the interesting stuff. So why proposing this talk? Being involved in Zephyr and active on Discord and GitHub, I'm usually answering the same questions that came from people that want to start their project on STM32 on Zephyr. So when questions are general, so this is general to Zephyr. Generally, information can be found quite easily inside the Zephyr documentation, at least when you want to start. But for vendors, there are some specifics. So there is device tree. There are common porting solutions, which is device tree and so on, common APIs. But there are still some specifics to each vendor, and frequently people can be stopped for whatever reason. And so, aim of this talk is to answer most of these questions if you want to start on STM32. Eventually, I hope that we'll find a solution to document this properly inside Zephyr documentation. So, what I hope you'll learn from this talk is what are STM32 resources, so documentation and so on that you will be able to use inside Zephyr. What is the coverage of STM32 part support? And then some information about really kind of hands-on how to configure stuff on a status on some particular subsystem. Okay, so a bit an overview about STM32 support in Zephyr. So whatever I will present today is really the result of a community contribution. So I've made a bit of statistics when preparing this talk, and I found that there were nearly 400 contributors, that issued more than 5,000 commits on a piece of code related to STM32. Could it be boards, device tree, drivers? There are more than 130 boards supported, more than 180 SoC supported across 19 STM32 series. More than 40 peripherals supported on a wide range of features. So could it be a trusted firmware, USB, Ethernet, CAN, BLE, LoRa, and so on. So about the resources. So there are two sides of these questions. Using Zephyr, you'll be able on STM32, you'll be able to benefit from the tools that are available for all the that are available for all the stock vendors, let's say. So GDB, OpenOCD, you'll benefit from Device 3. Using STM32, you will benefit as well from the STM32 Cube ecosystem. So we are using the STM32 Cube packages to implement the drivers. This one I'm using is not directly linked to implementation and so on, but this is the MCU Finder, which is perfect if you want to find documentation data sheets for any part or board. It's quite quite powerful database. You can use STM32 Cube Programmer to flash, STM32 Cube ID to debug. So this requires a particular setup, but it works. And you can use STM32 Cube Monitor tools for monitoring, for instance, power and so on your device. So about kubehl and kube packages, how we are integrating them. So for each STM32 series, we are collecting a fork of the official kube package inside HL STM32 module. So these packages are updated once per Zephyr release. So these are forks, and we are not technically forks because there are several Git project to one Git project, but Git repo to one Git repo. But so we are maintaining. We are so it's possible to maintain some fixes on top of the kube packages. So that, for instance, there is some incompatibility with Zephyr or bug identified that we know that will be released in the next kube package, we can temporarily maintain a fix. So we are able to progress on Zephyr and not being blocked by a delivery that will come later by the official STM32 kube package. And then STM32 Cube APIs are used for Zephyr driver development on STM32 parts. So this allows the reuse of validated code and mature code, and it allows also factorization. So for instance, we'll have, and this is mostly what the case for all drivers, but there will be only one driver that will support all STM32 series, so there is one UART STM32 driver that works across all the STM32 family, and the same for a lot of drivers like DSC, ADC, and so on. So we are using HL, LL, or SEM6 files, depending on driver specifics. So if you're not familiar with this terminology, HL is a provides a high-level abstraction on the STM32 peripherals. So it's quite powerful, full feature. It is quite useful to develop complex drivers like Ethernet, USB, and kind of drivers that are complex to implement and require a lot of stacks and so on. But we can also use LL APIs, which is a low-level API, so low-level because it's barely a register abstraction, and that allows to benefit from low footprint, and this is quite flexible to implement. It allows a good impedance matching with Zephyr APIs, and it allows to develop it's quite useful to develop simple drivers like UART, I2C, DSC, and so on. Yes, a few additional words about while I'm on the HL topics. There are as well CM6 files that are available in this module, and so here is an example of what I call a CM6 file, and this is a SOC description in C header, and that inside this header, you'll find a lot of information, well, the complete information, the complete description about the part, and this is generally helpful when you need to populate device tree entries like IRQ number, register base address, and so on. Sometimes it can happen that the Zephyr API does not support the features that you would need from the hardware block, but this functionality is available from the HL. You can totally in your application mix Zephyr and STM32Cube APIs. So this requires specific setup, but this is described just at the address which is there. And last word about the HLs is that there are asserts in STM32Cube HLs, and there is a way to enable them with this particular config setting. This can be useful for debugging. Okay, so now we'll enter the we'll put then really on the technical things. So the idea is how to set up a new a new board that would be using STM32 component in Zephyr. So this is a good way to start. So the first step is so this will be mostly device tree. So the first step is to include the DTSI for the STM32 part you will be using. For instance, here we are using a board which is based on STM32 H7B3XI. So it's not always easy to find your ways around this nomenclature. So in the SOC datasheet, you will find an explanation in the end of the datasheet about the nomenclature. So first, you'll get the name of the series. So this part is easy. Then you'll get the SOC variant. The next letter after the SOC variant is the pin count. So in this particular piece of information, we don't use it in when giving name to the SOC DTSI file, and we are using a X to state that we are not using it. And the last bit, the last letter, is the SOC package memory size, which is I in this case, and that is generally 2 MB. So if you want to use such part in the folder on DTS ARM STH7, you'll need to look for STM32 H7B3XY.DTSI. So you find the part, great. If you did not find the part that you're looking for, don't panic, there are solutions. So maybe the part that you want to use is a memory size variant. So it's the exact same part, but with a different flash size. So in that case, you can just add a new file and provide a new for the flash node, state a new size for the which is matching the part that you want to use. So in this particular example, this would be 1 MB flash variant, and we are just adding a new DTSI file which will be XJ instead of XI, and we are stating that the flash size is 1 MB. So this is the easiest issue that you can make. Then maybe you're using a different part which is not actually supported, not yet supported. So there are two ways. So either you're finding some part which is quite close from the one that you want to use. So to do that, what you can do is to check the datasheet, compare the CM6 files to see what are the difference with what is available in Zephyr on the part that you want to use. So either you find the description of something that is exactly matching your need, and you can use it directly. So either you need some adaptation, like for instance, here we can see that the H7B3 is a variant of the H7A3 plus crypto. So we are just including the H7A3 and we add the crypto node. And this is how we are building the whole device tree for STM32 parts. So this is relatively easy to add. And to add the node for a new new peripheral, in general, what is working in most of the cases is to seek for this node in series that are close or compatible with the series you're using. So once you have included the right parts, the next step is to configure clocks. So how to proceed? So there are four steps. So you might be familiar with this, but so what you would need to configure is first to configure the fixed clock, like high speed, internal or external, either configurable clocks or low speed clocks. Then you need to maybe you will want to use a PLL, so you have to configure the PLL and then configure the source clock for the core, and finally configure the peripheral bus speed. Normally, if you're doing this, things should work afterwards. So this is the theory, and technically, we are doing this using device tree for STM32 parts. So, for instance, here, what we are doing is that we are enabling the HSI48. We are enabling the HSE, so high-speed external clock with the clock frequency that is 24 megahertz. We are configuring the PLL. So PLL will take HSE as input. You can configure you have to configure the divisor multipliers, the prescalers for each clock output, or at least the one that you care. You can, if required, configure another PLL if you need to. And finally, within the RCC node, you have to configure the core. So here we are configuring the core source clock as the PLL. In this case, this will be the output, the output P of the PLL. You need to configure the clock frequency and configure the prescalers for each bus that is that will be used. So if you need help on this part, so you can look at the reference manual. In general, this is well explained how things work and what are the capabilities. If you don't manage using the reference manuals, you can use Cubemix, which is another part of the STM32 Cube ecosystem tools, and that has a way to generate valid cloud configuration. So this is a useful generally. Okay, so now that we have configured the clocks, maybe we want to configure the peripherals that will be used for the applications. What I would like to answer is what are the peripherals. How to know, how to identify what are the peripherals that are supported, what are the configurations that are supported for this peripheral, and how to configure the usual settings for this peripheral. So what are the supported peripherals? So once again, you'll find the answer inside device tree. So device tree is the main reference for a lot of things. So you need to find your DTSI file and look at the nodes that are inside this file and follow the inclusion shame scheme. And you'll have the overview of all the peripherals that are supported. If there is one instance of hardware block which is missing, like for instance you need to use a USART 6 and this one is missing, there are all the other USART or UART that are available, so you just need to add the missing node and populate its properties using once again the CM6 files that I mentioned earlier to get the base address, the clock configuration, and the interrupt number. So generally, this is the only thing that you need to do. And if there is a missing device, once again, need to check if there is a similar device available in a series which is compatible. And then, on the peripheral, I'm interested to how to know what are the possible what are the possible available configurations. Like for instance, is there a flow control that I can enable or pre-configure using device tree? Are there prescalers that I can set? So actually, what we want to know if this is supported by the driver. So in general, answer is once again inside device tree. There's a in the Zephyr documentation, there's a quite useful page, which is the binding index, where you'll find per vendor all the compatibles that are supported within Zephyr. And so you'll need to look for the compatible that you are interested in, and you'll see what are all the properties that are available and you can configure for your hardware block. So now we are getting to the common property settings that you need to configure to set up your peripheral. So let's say we want to use USART1 as a Zephyr console. So we'll need to enable USART node, so I will not go into device tree details, but just need to put status equal OK. But then what we want to do is to configure provide the pin configuration for this device. So you need to populate the pin control 0 property. And what we are providing to ease this step is we are providing pincontrol.dtsi files. And this is a usually tricky part is that these files are not within Zephyr folder. They are within Zephyr repo. They are available inside HLSTM32 repo. We are generating these files for each STM32 parts. So technically, if the part is available, you'll find the file that match your part. And the file is supposed to be complete for all the supported peripherals. So you'll find a configuration for your pin, for all the pins that are available on the part and for all the possible configurations. So we are generating this from a database which is provided by ST, and which is the same database that is used in Cubemx. So should theoretically be complete and have the correct information. One trick is that for some pin configuration nodes. So aside from the basic pin configuration, so for instance here we are stating that for USART1 TX to set it on PA9, so this can be maybe written too small, but We are stating that it's using GPIO A, pin 9, and Internet Function 7. So this is basically in what is required to configure a pin. And additionally, for some specific pin configuration, we are as well providing some enabling some property which is generally fitting the purpose of the pin. Like for instance, for URTX, we are setting a pull-up. So we are adding the pull-up property systematically for all these USRTX nodes. So in general, this should fit most of the applications, but if for specific reasons your board doesn't match this pre-configured setting, you just need to update the node in the in your DTS in your board DTS file, delete the property and add the property that that is fitting your configuration, like the pull down in this case, even if it might not make sense. But okay. One common issue in when using these files is that if there is some configuration issue within your manifest, you'll get this error stating that when compiling the device tree, the file is not found. So in general, west update command will solve the issue in most of the cases. So if you find this error, just run west update. It's also valid for a lot of other issues, but this works well in this case. If you're interested in using a microcontroller output, you can use also pin control properties. So this requires some, this is not fully implemented yet, but this is easy to enable within your application. So there is an issue where all the steps required to do that are explained, and it should be should not be a major issue. So next setting that you might want to use in your application is DMA. DMA is a bit tricky. Recognize that. So you need to add. To enable DMA, you will need to add DMA property, providing DMA names, enable the DMA devices, and provide the correct configuration in the DMA properties. I agree, this could be tricky. This should be correctly explained in the binding section. So you just need to find what is the DMA that is need to use to be used by your device, and look at the bindings, and there is an explanation on how to configure it, how to find the information from the reference manual and configure it properly. I hope that in medium term we'll be able to provide a pre-configuration on DMA, and you will not have to do that in your board configuration, and you eventually, I hope that we'll be able to just say DMA enabled as a property, and it will work with the pre-configured model. And last part, which is something relatively recent, is the support of domain clock. So what is domain clock? So it's used to support some specific cases, like if you need a 48 megahertz clock to schedule your hardware, like for USB for instance. If you need to select a specific PLL output for your IP, or you need for power management to have a clock which is persistent in stop mode. So there is a way to configure a specific MUX to state what will be the domain clock for my device. So this is something that we can see in QBMX. So this looks like this. So for my USART1, I can select a variety of sources. And this is the way you need to do it in device 3. So you just need to copy the initial clock configuration that you find in the DTI file and add on top of this the configuration that you want to use. So for instance, here I'm configuring the domain clock as HSI. So I know that if I enter the stop mode, HSI will still be present. And then I'm using this, there is a second property so this is the value that you're finding in the reference manual to know. So the value that has to be configured in the register. And you can find this in reference manual in the reset and clock controller section. And so, of course, we should not forget to enable the HSI clock. We are talking about power management. So, what is power management status? So the power management handling is made available per series basis. So this differs from the driver implementation, in which generally whatever feature you want to support, it's generally once it's supported in the driver, it's generally available for all the series. And this is not the case for power management, where this is implemented so far per series. So you'll need to check the code and see, so for my specific series in the SOC top folder, what are the modes that are implemented. So this should be implemented for all the series that are low power ones, like LX series and so on. For the series that are high performance, like F4, F7, and so on, it is not supported. So yes, you'll see what are the states supported. I will not enter into the details about how to configure the stop mode. So this is already documented in Zephyr documentation, because this is quite these are Zephyr common bindings, so this is properly documented. Just one thing that you need to know is that if you want to enable power management, so using config PM by enabling config PM. What you need to do additionally is to enable a kernel tick source that will remain available when the core clock is gated. So usually the kernel tick source is a Cortex-C stick, but when we enter power management modes like stop zero, starting from stop zero, the C stick will stop and the kernel is losing his tick source, which is a problem when you want to wake up. So for STM32, what we are using is a LPTIM, which is a low power timer, and that will work in these low power modes, and that is used as the kernel tick source when doing power management. So once again, you need to configure it in device 3. And this should work. Also note that if you want to make some, so this is not in the documentation, but this is generally useful, there are some power management samples that works on STM32 that are available inside sample boards STM32 power management. And these are dedicated to STM32 and can help to test specific configurations. So this is in power management in Zephyr, there are various levels. So there is the general base power management level, and then there are PM device power management level. This power management level is implemented, has to be implemented device per device. And so you need to look at the code to see how on which device it is implemented. So for now, it is a GPIO, UART, I2C. You'll find, once again, you'll find in the samples, you'll find examples of configuration. I will not go into the details because I'm a bit late. I have not much more time left, so I will speed up a bit. One point about a trusted firmware M. So if you're interested in trusted firmware M, basically you should know how it works. An important thing to know about STM32 configuration is that trusted firmware, the non-secure side is, will run in it will be run by the TFM, and the global partitioning of the platform is also done by the trusted firmware, and you need to match your board flash partition to the partition which is configured by trusted firmware, and the source file to find what is the actual flash layout that you're supposed to do is available in TFM. It's not easy to find, for each platform that support TFM, you'll find a flash layout, and your application has to match the partition which is done by TFM. I've provided here an example of the mapping that you need to do between the partition done in trusted firmware and the usual partition that we are doing in Zephyr. Okay, the next step on STM32 subsystem, we need to extend the power management support and complete it. We'll work as well on supporting XIP on external memories. Not there yet. We're starting working on it. We'll try to stick as usually with Zephyr Evolution, like USB, DMA, and so on, and keep an eye on the backlog. I'm done with the things that I wanted to share. Don't hesitate to jump in. Ask questions if you need an STM32 channel in Discord. Don't hesitate to contribute your change and fixes. We are welcoming any changes, feature addition, and fixes. Don't hesitate to watch the areas that you care about in GitHub. If you're a heavy user of ADC, watch the changes that are made, because there are a lot of pull requests that are made by the community. We are at level about 50 pull requests that are done per month on STM32 CUD, on STM32 area and drivers. This is a lot of work. So it can sometimes happen that we are merging stuff that maybe should not have been merged, but we're trying to test everything. But sometimes you guys may have better test setup and have better applications than we have to test every changes. So don't hesitate to watch the areas that you care about to review, to help us in review, and that's it for me. I don't know if we have time for questions.
We probably do. Thank you very much. There is a couple of questions in the live chat, and then we probably have time for one or two questions in the room as well. Generating the device tree for parts or parts of it could be done maybe from a CubeMX project. Is this something that you've considered or that we might see in the future?
The question is, yes, did we consider to use CubeMX to generate device tree stuff? So this will this won't happen soon. If this would happen one day, so I would love it. But this is not in CubeMX plan for now.
Tam Hanatan Wogemund Holdings, a question. Why was, the purchase of Atolik was originally intended to clean up the STM32 ecosystem. And when the U5 was introduced, there was a public statement made that Azure Arthos, formerly ThreadX Logic, will be the main operating system used for SGS Thompson microcontrollers in the future. I mean, my company, we are a user of SGS Thompson products ourselves. And I wanted to ask, why are we now having yet another operating system in the ecosystem?
When you mean other operating system, be it Zephyr or
yes, why is there now also support for Zephyr? Originally, the statement was that from the U5 onward, there will only be Azure Arthos going to the future.
Well, this is so. The question is why we are adding support on STM32 U5 on Zephyr, and well, this is a community, this is open source project, so. We did it actually, but if I have not done it, anyone from the community could have done it. And if it was done properly, I would have merged it with pleasure, as it happened on C0 recently. Thank you. And so, yes, this is open source. You cannot block things. This is a community work.
All right, and I think we're running out of time. Thank you again, everyone.
Okay, thank you.